On the 15th of April 1912, on board an upside-down lifeboat, 30 men began to witness a significant and dark event in maritime history. The lifeboat that held the men was Collapsible Lifeboat B. Collapsible Lifeboat B and the men who were on her were key witnesses to the sinking of the White Star Liner. However, this boat hasn't been fully documented. This documentary is about to change all that. From Second Officer Charles Lightoller and his near brush to death near the boat, the Colonel, who nearly went down with the Titanic before her final plunge, and the teen who helped an oceanographer to locate the ship's resting place. This is the story of Collapsible Lifeboat B and her men. By around 12:30 a.m., most first-class passengers had come out on deck, but there was a haze of confusion, wondering what was going on. Most of the passengers remained calm, though millions of questions had circled inside their heads. Despite this, the process of passengers getting into the lifeboats had begun. Although it isn't clear what time he agreed to do this, Colonel Archibald Gracie volunteered to assist women into the lifeboats, and with Smith and steward Charles Cullen, the trio gave extra blankets for the occupants in the lifeboats. At 12:36 a.m. on the starboard side, the first lifeboat, Lifeboat 7, was launched with 28 people on board, although its capacity was 65 persons. It was while the loading of the next lifeboat was being uncovered when, around the same time, a cry came from the crow's nest, maybe from lookouts Alfred Evans or George Hogg, who reported to be the last lookouts on the Titanic before she went down. Fourth Officer Boxhall would be the first to hear this cry and the reason why it was called.
Taken off the boat covers on the boat deck when I heard the crow's nest report a light on the starboard bow. Well, I went on the bridge right away. I found this light with my own glasses, but I wanted the telescope to define what it was, and I realized then that it was two mast headlights of a steamer below the horizon. And the lights were very close, and I went back and told the captain, there's a steamer in sight, very nearly ahead, but slightly on the starboard bow. And if she continues on her course, she'll pass close to us down the port side. Oh, I asked the captain, shall I send up some distress rockets, sir?
The captain agreed, and Boxhall went on to prepare the Morse lamp to send codes to this light. When Boxhall was preparing the Morse lamp, other passengers had begun to notice the light, too. One of them was from Colonel Archibald Gracie. Gracie was comforting four ladies who were feeling disturbed. It was then that he saw the light on the port side of the ship. In his memoir, Gracie would describe how he comforted the ladies. Our hopes were buoyed with the information imparted through the ship's offices that there had been an interchange of wireless messages with passing ships, one of which was certainly coming to our rescue. To reassure the ladies of whom I assumed special charge, I showed them a bright white light of what I took to be a ship about 5 miles off and which I felt sure was coming to our rescue. Not long after, Gracie and another passenger, Colonel John Jacob Astor IV, were seen leaning over the rails by the Titanic's bow. In the first class lounge at 12:45 a.m., Jack Thayer, his parents, and their maid were still waiting for an announcement from the crew members while they were continuing to prepare the lifeboats. It wasn't long before the call came. Shortly, we heard the stewards passing the word around, all women to the port side. We then said goodbye to my mother at the head of the stairs on A deck, and then she and the maid went out on the port side of that deck, supposedly to get into a lifeboat. Father and I went out on the starboard side, watching what was going on about us. It seemed we were always waiting for an orders, and no orders came. Around this same time, the first distress rocket was launched. Boxhall would go on to describe how he and Quartermaster Robert Hickens began sending off and carried on firing rockets.
We started sending off these distress rockets, the Quartermaster and I on the bridge. But I never knew how many I had fired. I knew very well that there were some in the box. A box holds a dozen, and when I told the captain, I said, there are still some in there, sir, but I don't know how many I fired. I didn't see any reply. Some of the passengers that was on the bridge said that they did see a reply. We also called up the ship as she drew closer with a Morse lamp, a very powerful Morse lamp that we had. And eventually, this steamer approached and approached until you could see all our lights with a naked eye. And I should say that she must have been within 5 miles off. You could not only see her lights with a naked eye, but you could see the lights in her portholes. So I reckon that she must have been within 5 miles. And then eventually she turned away and showed a stern light.
Everyone hoped that this ship would instantly come to the rescue and that it wouldn't be long before a transfer would begin from the sinking Titanic to the ship upon arrival. How wrong their positive thoughts and hopes were for this ship never came whatsoever. After receiving help from various ships, including the Titanic sister ship, the RMS Olympic, Harold Bride walked towards the wheelhouse from the Marconi room where had Jack Phillips on his own for a while. At 12:49 a.m., Bride arrived and saw the captain who was waiting in the wheelhouse. Upon their meeting, Bride informed him about the Carpathia. "Sir, the Carpathia is on our way to us. She is pressing her engines." "Please lead the way back to the Marconi room, Mr. Bride," replied Captain Smith. "I'll follow you." Upon the men's return 1 minute later, they found Jack Phillips continuing to send messages. In a slight moment, Captain Smith asked the senior operator, "Are there any other ships you were in communication with, Phillips?" "The Olympic's now responding to our call, sir," was his reply. The captain then asked, "What is the distance between the Carpathia and our position?" "They just said they are 58 miles off, sir." Suddenly, the men made light of the disaster. When Harold Bride cried after Phillips answered the captain, saying he was sending the CQD signal, "Send SOS," I said. "It's a new call, and it may be your last chance to send it." Making this change a theme for creating a wicked sense of humor, though the laughs weren't genuine, it was this joke that would have saved lives that night, and this in turn would make the operators one of the many heroes of the tragedy. Before 1:10 a.m., Lightoller began loading the women and children into lifeboat number 4 when he noticed that the windows on A deck were locked. As a result, he transferred passengers to climb into number 6. While transferring the passengers, he saw a stubborn woman named Margaret Brown. Brown was walking away from a lifeboat, refusing to get in one. Quickly, he picked her up and carried her back while crying, "You are going in too!" She ended up joining the occupants in lifeboat number 6. Around the same time, Colonel Archibald Gracie was assisting his friend Helen Churchill Candy. She too would board lifeboat number 6. In total, 23 people boarded the ship. However, the lifeboat stopped halfway when a woman cried, "We've only got one seaman in this boat." In response, Lightoller halted the lifeboat and called for a seaman. Eventually, a man by the name of Major Arthur Pukins would step in to volunteer, and despite being a yachtsman, Lightoller accepted the Major's offer by saying, "If you are a sailor enough to get out on that fall, you can go down." The Major did that, and Lightboat 6 rowed away from the ship while Quartermaster Robert Hickens taking the helm. The Major would be the only male passenger Lightoller led on that night. Down below on B deck, Jack Thayer and his parents, Margaret Fleming and Milton Long, were caught in a milling crowd after they left A deck to try to find a lifeboat for Marion Thayer. Thayer didn't give an estimated time of when this event occurred, but seeing his family all together would be the very last time. "As we went through the doorway out onto the boat deck, people pushed between my father and mother and Long and me. Long and I could not catch up, and we were entirely separated from them." When they were separated from John, Marion, and Margaret Fleming, Thayer and Milton Long were searching around for them on the port side. Failing to find them, both men went back through the lounge on the starboard side. In the Marconi room, Jack Phillips continued to send messages to many ships, including the Olympic, the RMS Baltic, and the SS Asian. However, by 1:14 a.m., the signal had become very faint. It would be the starting point of the Titanic's power to go out. Around 1:14 a.m., the orchestra went out onto the boat deck and began to play a song, "The Land of Hope and Glory." Rockets were continuing to fire in the hopes that the mysterious ship would come, and by this time, boiler room number 4 was flooding, which indicated that there wasn't long to go. Over at Lifeboat 12, Second Officer Charles Lightoller and Chief Officer Henry Tingle Wild were supervising passengers while they were climbing into the boat. In this one, there were 40 people, including second-class passenger Brenda LeMond, who was guided to the boat by one of the orchestra musicians, Roger Brucraw. LeMond would describe what had happened before she went with Brucraw-Hawks into lifeboat number 12. I asked him what was wrong. He just told me that we would have to go on another boat to get to New York and that I should go down and get my coat. I went, and when I came back, he put a lifebelt on me and took me to another deck. He said to a couple officers that there was another lady. Lifeboat 12 was launched at 1:30 a.m. However, as it was lowering, one young man had jumped in. It's not known who this man is. Meanwhile, Jack Thayer and Milton Long had finished running to the starboard side, and the two men noticed that by 1:30 a.m., the Titanic was weighed down by the head. At that point, the Titanic's nameplate had begun to dip in the North Atlantic Ocean. After being allowed to make their way to the upper decks, though it's not clear when the order was given, Eugene Daly and his two female companions arrived on A deck, horrified to discover that most of the lifeboats were gone. While the orchestra resumed playing ragtime tunes, Daly and the women found lifeboat number 13. The trio boarded, but Daly heard a voice shouting at him to get out. He did so, and the women remained in the lifeboat. At the same time, lifeboat 15 was lowered, but Daly did not attempt to climb in it. Third-class steward Sidney Daniels almost left the Titanic on lifeboat 13 as he had been assigned to the boat. In his testimony, he described what happened when he decided against leaving the ship. We were allowed certain boats to go to, and mine was number 13, by the way, and to get, well, we were just stood around waiting for orders, dancing around to the musicians because the musicians were on board, playing the different tunes on deck, and eventually they got orders to get all the women and children up to their lifeboats. I don't know what time was, but it was getting on. Anyway, we got them all up, well, as many as we could, and we got them into the boats. We had to forfeit our seats on the boat, of course, with the passengers. Daniels and Daly would remain on board for the rest of the ship sinking. When Lifeboat 13 had been launched, Colonel Archibald Gracie and Clint Smith had seen a group of men trying to swamp Lifeboat number 2. Second Officer Charles Lightoller had first noticed the madness, and when he ran over to the boat, he jumped and threatened the man with a gun, crying, "Get out, you damned cowards! I'd like to see every one of you overboard!" The second officer and colonel came across paths during the ordeal of the sinking, where he assisted Lightoller and the other officers to get women and children into the lifeboats. Once, when Gracie helped a woman to get into lifeboat number 4 while holding her baby in his arms, he helped his John Jacob Astor IV's pregnant wife, which is Madeline Astor, into the boat, and another time when he grabbed Edith Corse Evans and Carolyn Brown by each arm for them to reach a lifeboat, while he had been blocked by a for said line of crew members, with one officer informing Gracie that only women could pass. However, the only officer who would let him assist the lifeboats was Lightoller, who Gracie would later describe as, who did their duty as if similar occurrences were matters of daily routine. When he and Clinch Smith arrived to help Lightoller once again for lifeboat number 2, he would assist more women and children into a lifeboat. Lightoller and Wild launched the lifeboat with 4th Officer Joseph Boxhall in command. Around this time, Captain Edward J. Smith, after ordering Boxhall to go onto lifeboat number 2, walked back to the Marconi wireless room where Jack Phillips was sending the Olympic's wireless operator either Ernest James Moore or Alfred Begat. MGY to MKC. We are putting the women off in the boats. We are putting passengers off in small boats. Women and children in the boats cannot last much longer, losing power. Just as Phillips sent the message, the captain came in, telling him and Bride, she is not lasting very long. The engine rooms are taking on water and that the dynamos might fail on you any minute now. As he left, Phillips continued communicating, messaging these haunting words, engine room getting flooded.
Engine room getting flooded.
By this time, people were starting to panic, and while Bride heard passengers running outside their cabin to reach the boat deck, Bride would later praise Phillips in his testimony. And how poor Phillips worked through it, I don't know. He was a brave man. I learned to love him that night, and I suddenly felt for him a great reverence to see him standing there, sticking to his work, while everyone else was raging about. Meanwhile, Chief Baker Charles Yalkin was seen scampering down the stairs to his cabin on E-deck, where he had poured in what seemed to be his third bottle of alcohol. Earlier in the sinking, Yalkin had been assigned to lifeboat number 10 as a skipper. However, At the last moment, Chief Officer Henry T. Wilds decided that Steward William Burke should take charge, along with two other seamen. In between the decision, Yalcom would descend to A deck to look for more women and children with Burke and a handful of sailors and stewards. Although the women didn't want to leave their husbands or elder sons behind, and in a few cases some women ran away from the lifeboat, believing that they'd be safer on board the Titanic, the group had to forcibly take women and children up on deck. But by the time Yalcom got up once more, nearly to the time the lifeboat was launched, the ship had already taken a sharp list to port. In haste, many women and children were thrown from the boat deck to lifeboat number 10. Suddenly, in one attempt, one woman lost her footing and she slipped between the lifeboat and the Titanic, hung upside down. By a miracle whatsoever, she was caught by Burke and was hauled aboard into A deck. At that moment, both Yalcom and Wild had noticed that the boat was half-filled and would become crowded as some passengers tried scrambling into boat 10. In the British Inquiry, Yalcom described this scene. They were getting the boat ready for getting the passengers in, and Mr. Wild shouted out for the stewards to keep the people back, to keep the men back. But there was no necessity for it. The men kept back themselves, and we made a line and passed the ladies and children through. Lifeboat 10 was launched at 1:50 a.m., around the same time that the rockets ceased firing and any hope of the rescue ship reached the sinking Titanic. The flame that shone so bright a while ago was snuffed out like a candle. While Phillips was continuing to send distress calls, as according to Harold Bride, the forward well deck was awash with a strong list increasing on Titanic's port side, and the situation became desperate, and that steerage passengers and stokers were trying to find a lifeboat, causing a great stampede. Gunshots were rung, but they were likely came from Collapsible C. One of the passengers who was heading toward Collapsible C was third class passenger Eugene Daly. Daly, who failed getting into lifeboat 13, tried to find a way to find a lifeboat. Eventually, he managed to find the collapsible and attempt to find a spot. However, as it was being ready for launch, he would get caught by the huge crowd. He would later describe the scene to the Carpathia's doctor. Finally, some of the women and children were let up, but as you know, we had quite a number of hot-headed Italians and other people who got crazy and made for stairs. These men tried to rush the stairway, pushing and crowding and pulling the women down, some of them with weapons in their hands. I saw two dagger shots and some that took punishment from the officers. Witnessing the scenario were Colonel Archibald Gracie and another passenger, Hugh Woolner. When he was interviewed in the U.S. Inquiry, Woolner recalled that he saw two flashes of a pistol in the air. However, Jack Thayer, who likely witnessed this incident in the crowds with Milton Long, said that it wasn't Murdoch, but it was Purser H.W. McElroy who shot the gun. Thayer would describe this scene. Two men, I think they were in the dining room stewards, dropped into the boat from the deck above. As they jumped, he fired twice in the air. I do not believe they were hit, but they were quickly thrown out. McElroy was calmed to be standing up in the collapsible while attempting to keep the crowds under control, similar to the actions of First Officer William Murdoch. But since Daly and Thayer saw different men, we can agree that both Murdoch and McElroy were there all together. However, McElroy likely fired the two pistol shots in the air while standing inside Collapsible C, while Murdoch held his gun and was the one who threatened to shoot any man who attempted to board Collapsible C. Despite the threats, Daly claimed that two men stepped forward with one who tried to climb Murdoch's feet. Both men were shot, although one died instantly. Daly did not attempt to reach Collapsible C and the loading resumed. When the situation had calmed down, Thomas Andrews noted that the lifeboats were not being filled, including Lifeboat 1, which had 12 people on board. After seeing one last attempt to recall the boats to occupy more passengers, Captain Smith accompanied either by Second Officer Charles Lightoller or Chief Officer Henry Wild. With one of them blowing a whistle, Captain Smith began issuing orders for all lifeboats to return to the Titanic to come around on the starboard side. Sadly, only one lifeboat returned, and that was Lifeboat Number 2 with Fourth Officer Boxhall. No remaining passengers would ever be collected. In the Marconi wireless room, Jack Phillips had lost contact with the Cape Race, but he wasn't giving up on messaging all ships who were nearby to rescue the Titanic. At 1:57 a.m., moments after the failed attempt to recall all the lifeboats, Captain Smith had entered the room where he showed a solemn expression on his face before giving these instructions. "Men, you have done your full duty. You can do no more. Abandon your cabin. Now it's every man for himself. In shock, Phillips looks up for a second where he makes eye contact with the captain. Captain Smith places a hand on Phillips' shoulder before saying these final words to him and Harold Pride, "You look out for yourselves. I release you." Then the captain made a final remark before leaving the wireless room for the last time. "That's the way of it at this kind of time. Every man for himself." Despite the humane orders, of course, Phillips didn't give up as he continued messaging the SS Virginia, the Baltic, and the SS Asian. Back on the boat deck, Jack Thayer and Milton Long were searching for another lifeboat, but the men remained either next to or near Collapsible C, where he caught a glimpse of J. Bruce Ismay near Collapsible C. "I saw Ismay, who had been assisting in the loading of the last lifeboat, push his way into it. It was every man for himself." With no luck in finding a place in the lifeboat, they tried to find another way to leave the sinking vessel. At 2 a.m., all the 16 regular lifeboats had left the Titanic, with the exception of three Engelhart lifeboats, Collapsible A, B, and D. When the attention had been paid to them, the first to be lifted was Collapsible D. With the assistance of Second Officer Charles Lightoller and with Colonel Archibald Gracie assisting women passengers, Chief Officer Henry T. Wilde and a handful of crew members prepared Collapsible D by hooking it to the tackles in the same davits where Lifeboat 2 was before the boat was launched. The crew had formed a ring around this collapsible boat to allow only women to enter this lifeboat. But because of the limited time the Titanic was in, Lightoller changed his mind and he decided to allow men to take the vacant seats. It was while loading that Wilde had ordered Lightoller to take command of Collapsible D. "Not damn likely," replied Lightoller before he stepped back on deck. It was clear that because of the rising water, the second officer was assisting the passengers into the boat. But because he had no intention of going in, Lightoller decided to remain on the Titanic so the last two lifeboats could be launched. Collapsible D was launched around 2:02 a.m. By then, the water was rapidly flooding A deck. When the time came to launch Collapsible A and B, Lightoller and Gracie saw that both would be hard to release as they were still upon top of the officers' quarters, hanging upside down. They had to act quickly, but the question is, how? Back in the Marconi wireless room, and despite being released by Captain Smith, Jack Phillips continued sending out messages, but by then, the signal was close to dying and Phillips couldn't hear the last messages from Cape Race and the SS Virginia, who suggested Phillips try to use the Titanic's emergency set. At 2:10 a.m., Harold Bright kept protesting to Phillips that it was hopeless to reach further contact and that the pair needed to leave. Phillips ignored his colleague even when the water was rising in the room. Then a dramatic event occurred. In a report he wrote to the traffic manager of the Marconi Company, Bride would describe the event and the time both men left the Marconi wireless room. "Leaving Mr. Phillips operating, I went to our sleeping cabin and got all our money together, returning to find a fireman or a coal trimmer gently relieving Mr. Phillips of his life belt. There immediately followed a general scrimmage with the three of us. I regret to say that we left to hurry to take the man in question with us, and without a doubt he sank with the ship in the Marconi cabin as we left him. There immediately followed a general scrimmage with the three of us. I regret to say that we left to hurry to take the man in question with us, and without a doubt he sank with the ship in the Marconi cabin as we left him. I up to this time kept the PV entered up, intending when we left the ship to tear out the lot and each to take a copy, but now we could hear the water washing over the boat deck and Mr. Phillips said, 'Come, let's clear out.' We had nearly the whole time been in possession of full power from the ship's dynamo, though towards the end the light sank and we were ready to stand by, with emergency apparatus and candles, but there was no necessity to use them. Leaving the cabin, we climbed on top of the house, comprising the officers' quarters and our own, and there I saw the last of Mr. Phillips, for he disappeared walking aft." By the time they ran out onto the boat deck, Bride Phillips had parted ways for a brief moment, knowing he couldn't do anything. Bride hurried towards Collapsible B, where he would meet Lightoller, Gracie, third-class passenger Eugene Daly, and third-class steward Sidney Daniels. When Bribe arrived at 2:10 a.m., the orchestra began to play its final tune, Near My God to Thee, while seven men, including Lightoller, were attempting to release Collapsible B while a group of passengers were ringing around the officers' quarters. One of them was Eugene Daly, who ran towards the quarters. When he arrived, the water was beginning to inundate the forward well deck. However, Daly had noticed that Collapsible B was trapped underneath the cables that supported the funnels. It wasn't clear where he was at the time, but Sidney Daniels had a chance to volunteer to release the trapped collapsible. In his interview, he described how he freed the boat. "We got away from that and got all the boats away excepting the last boat, which was the collapsible boat, secured to the top of the wireless room, and was lashed down with different lashings, and a crowd were up there unlashing it. Someone shouted out, 'Anyone got a pocket knife?' I said, 'Yes, I have. Here you are.' Passing my pocket knife up, and I think they cut the last lashings to the upturned lifeboat." Although Daniels never named the person to whom he gave his knife to, it is known that the person was Charles Lightoller. Thanks to the actions of Daniels, Lightoller was able to strip the covers and cut away the ropes before Collapsible B went down to the deck. However, the collapsible landed upside down, and it landed on top of the junior wireless operator, Harold Bride. In his newspaper account, Bribe would describe how he was trapped underneath the collapsible. "I went to the place where I had seen the collapsible boat on the boat deck, and to my surprise, I saw the lifeboat and the men still trying to push it off. I guess there wasn't a sailor in the crowd. They couldn't do it. I went up to them and was just lending a hand when a large wave came awash on the deck. The big wave carried the boat off. I had hold of an oarlock and I went off with it." Bride would later leave the Titanic when the collapsible floated away from the boat deck.
By the time Collapsible Boat B was being thrown off the, I would say thrown, because it practically was, when it was thrown off the officers' quarters on the port side, this was when the sinking was becoming, flooding was now coming up onto the boat deck. She was leaning over to the port side. At this point, she didn't quite correct herself until the bridge started to submerge. Something kind of shifted inside, but it would have been immense panic. But I suppose what could have been different with the lifeboats in general, especially on the boat deck, is not the boat deck, but the officers' quarters, is basically they should have had a better system of getting them off, because just throwing a boat off the top of an officer's quarters and hope for the best isn't exactly good enough, really, in my view, because you don't know what's going to happen to the boat. It could break. You know, things could, you know what I mean? It could become completely useless. But men were using oars and everything to get underneath it, to shift it. But you've got to imagine, it's a heavy boat, a really heavy boat, and you've got several men, really giving it everything they've got to get this boat off the quarters, the officers' quarters. Everyone was screaming and crying, and the band was playing, and the water was coming up. The ship was grinding, and metallic sounds were coming from it. It was just like hell unleashed itself. Just imagine the freezing cold water, like 1,000 knives stabbing into your body. How painful it would have been to enter those waters. I mean, I couldn't imagine it. It was a painful death. And it was an agonizing one too. It must have felt like forever.
Colonel Archibald Gracie and Clinch Smith had noticed that the Titanic's bridge had gone underwater. Leaving Lightoller, the men headed for the stern, where they met a crowd of steerage passengers who were also trying to get away from the ship. My friend Clinch Smith made the proposition that we should leave and go towards the stern, but there arose before us from the decks below a mass of humanity, several lines deep, converging on the boat deck, facing us and completely blocking our passage to the stern. There were women in the crowd as well as men, and these seemed to be steerage passengers who had just come up from the decks below. Even among these people, there were no hysterical cry, no evidence of panic. Not long after they remained on the stern, a rush of water engulfed the pair. In one desperate attempt, Gracie jumped into the ocean, but he was caught a hold of the bottom rung of the ladder to the roof of the officers' quarters. Although he pulled himself up, Gracie was pulled back down into the deep water. Clinch Smith was never seen again. Cindy Daniels also attempted to take a sun dive into the ocean. Third-class passenger Eugene Naley dived overboard just as the Titanic took a great plunge forward. Second officer Charles Lightower, noticing the plunge, decided to dive into the sea himself, and when he began to swim, he immediately got sucked down against a large ventilator shaft. In his interview for the BBC, Lightower went on to describe what happened while he was swimming for his life.
I turned forward and took a header from the top of the wheelhouse. I started to swim away, but got sucked down two or three times. In fact, I got mighty near the edge of things before I finally came up alongside the collapsible. We'd hove into the water from the top of the officers' quarters, and there I hung on. A bit later, the forward funnel guys carried away, and the funnel, weighing perhaps 50 or 60 tons, fell down with a crash on the water. It missed the raft and some of us hanging onto it by inches. But there were a good many it didn't miss. Next thing I remember, I was still hanging on to a bit of rope attached to the raft, but some 30 or 40 yards away from the ship. The wash of the falling funnel had evidently picked us up, raft and all, and flung us clear of the ship altogether. Several of us scrambled up onto the slippery bottom of the raft, and it was from there I saw the Titanic sink.
Around this time, he climbed up onto the raft of Collapsible B. Lightower was joined by junior wireless operator Harold Bride, who had swam away from the ship after resurfacing from the water. However, before he did so, Bride claimed that he saw a known figure jumping into the water. Just as the boat fell, I noticed Captain Smith dive from the bridge into the sea. It was the same for trimmer James McGann, though he was closer to Captain Edward J. Smith, who had been with him before the pair jumped into the water trying to save children who had been left on the boat deck. He held a little girl under one arm, and as he jumped into the sea in an endeavor to reach the nearest lifeboat with the child, I took the other child into my arms and I was swept from the bridge deck. When I was plunged into the cold water, I was compelled to release my hold under the child, and I am satisfied that the same thing happened to Captain Smith. It was around the same time that McGann helped Charles Lightower, Sidney Daniels, and Colonel Archibald Gracie, and he became one of the seven men who had assisted in lowering Collapsible B. Before he jumped in, McGann said that Captain Smith had tears in his eyes. While trying to fight back the tears, McGann described what he believed would have been the last time he'd see the captain alive. He turned to the men lowering the boat and shouted, "Well, boys, it's every man for himself." He then took one of the children standing by him on the bridge and jumped into the sea. Back on the Titanic, three more men were continuing to fight for their lives as the Titanic was in the final few minutes of the ship's life. After Lifeboat 10 was lowered into the sea, Chief Baker Charles Yalkin went down below E deck, where he returned to his cabin one last time to drink liquor. On his way up to the boat deck, he caught the Titanic surgeon, Dr. William O'Loughlin, where they had mid-conversation on the rising water and on C deck, and believed that the water was going from the open watertight door and was flowing to port. Just as they were about to move on, both men met two other unidentified men who told Yalkin they were going to close the doors using a large spanner. However, Yalkin never got to see them do this, for he went to return to the boat deck, where he threw around 50 deck chairs overboard from B deck. Not long after that, he went to the A deck pantry to get a drink of water. Dr. O'Loughlin was never seen again. While he was in the pantry, he noticed something odd. And while I was getting a drink of water, I heard a kind of a crash as if something had buckled, as if part of the ship had buckled. Then I heard a rush overhead. In this quote, Yalkin realized that the ship was in the early stages of breaking in half, presumably down a small staircase that ran flush with the ship's third funnel. In swift action, Yalkin headed for the stern before making his way to the poop deck. When I got up on top, I could then see them clambering down from those decks. Of course, I was at the tail end of the rush. You could have heard it, but you could not know what it was. It was not an explosion or anything like that. It was as if the iron was parting. While Yalkin was struggling for survival, Jack Thayer and Milton Long were climbing up the starboard side of the Titanic before they had clung onto the railings, sheltering the stairway abreast of the second funnel. While there, Thayer began doubt about being rescued, and he had a feeling that he wouldn't survive the night. Prepared for the worst, though, he would take time to think about the memories he had had of his family and how thankful he was to know them. Suddenly, Thayer and Long felt the structure beginning to fail. Without warning, she seemed to start forward, moving forward and into the water at an angle of about 15 degrees. This movement, with the water rushing up towards us, was accompanied by a rumbling roar, mixed with more muffled explosions. It was like standing under a steel railway's bridge while an express train passes overhead, mingled with the noise of a pressed steel factory and wholesale breakage of China. Long and I had been standing by the starboard rail about abreast of the second funnel. Our main thought was to keep away from the crowd and the suction. At the rail, we were entirely free of the crowd. We had previously decided to jump into the water before she would go down so that we might swim some distance away and avoid what we thought would be a terrific suction. Still, we did not wish to jump before the place where we were standing would be only a few yards over the water, for we might be injured and not be able to swim. Having no time to act, both Thayer and Long shook hands and wished each other good luck. Milton Long would be lost in the sinking. After wishing his friend good luck, Thayer threw off his overcoat and climbed over the rail before sitting on it. Seconds later, he jumped into the water. The distance between the feet of the ship and the water was as high as 15 feet. Once Thayer was in the water, he was suddenly sucked down into the deck below before being pushed out by the backwash and was being sucked down once again before he nearly died. The second funnel, large enough for two automobiles to pass through abreast, seemed to be lifted off, emitting a cloud of sparks. It missed me by 20 or 30 feet. The suction of it drew me down and down, struggling and swimming, practically spent. As I finally came to the surface, I put my hand over my head to push away any obstruction. My hand then came against something smooth and firm with a rounded shape. I looked up and realized that it was the cork fender of one of the collapsible lifeboats, which was floating in the water bottom side up. While Thayer was struggling in the water, Colonel Archibald Gracie was attempting to free himself as the Titanic was gravitating underneath the ocean, and the undertow was pulling him down. I was loaded down with a heavy long-skirted overcoat and Norfolk coat underneath, with clumsy life preserver overall, which made my jump fall short. As I came down, the water struck my right side. I crouched down into the preparatory to jumping with it and rose as if the crest of a wave on the seashore. This expedient brought in the attainment of the object I had in view. I was able to reach the roof and the iron railing that is along the edge of it and pulled myself over on top of the officer's house and on my stomach near the base of the second funnel. I was in a whirlpool of water swirling around and around as I still tried to cling to the railing as the ship plunged to the depths below. Down. Down I went, it seemed a great distance. While Gracie was fighting for his life, third-class steward Sidney Daniels attempted to get away from the suction once he had jumped into the water. I had nowhere to swim to, but I just had to get away from the suction. That's what I feared. The suction of the vessel would take me down. Well, I swam away, and by sheer good luck, I came across a life buoy, and one of the big life buoys was another man clinging to it. Well, I looked around, and I said to this fellow, I said, "We're too near for the suction. She'll suck us down." I turned and swam away again. No objective, just swam away. This other fellow, well, he never answered me. I don't know who he was, but I think he followed me and in the distance, well, in the darkness. I could see something black, so I swam to that, and it was an upturned lifeboat with a crowd on there. It was the last lifeboat on there, the one I helped cut adrift, so I climbed on there. Well, the other fellow followed me. He tried to climb on too, but he was too exhausted to get on fully on there. I managed to sit up on the keel of the lifeboat, but he just laid across there. He eventually died of exposure. Around the same time, third-class passenger Eugene Daly swam towards Collapsible B before pulling himself on board. He said that his overcoat kept him warm, even in the water. He couldn't feel the temperature of the water, but when he climbed on top, he saw people jumping overboard the Titanic and feared that the stern, which was swaying around, would keel over and land on them. But it didn't, and he would survive that night. Managing to hold his place on the collapsible, Second Officer Charles Lightoller would become witness to the Titanic's final minutes of the ship's life above the waves.
"As I watched, I could see her bow getting deeper and deeper in the water, with the foremast sticking up above the surface, whilst her stern lifted higher and higher till it was right out of the water. When she got to an angle of about 60 degrees, there was a sullen sort of rumbling roar as her massive boilers all left their beds and went crashing down through the bulk's heads and everything that stood in their way.
Around the same time, while still swimming, First Class Passenger Jack Thayer had described the ship breaking into two pieces and the third funnel collapsing into the water. However, he was later recalled that the event by saying that the dummy funnel never fell into the sea. Not long afterwards, Thayer was pulled out of the water and spent the rest of the night kneeling while junior wireless operator Harold Bride had laid across in front of him. From Thayer's account, it is possible that what the 17-year-old saw was in a close view when the ship broke in half, though it's not clear what the distance was. However, it is thought that the breakup did more damage comparing to this recent theory to previous ones which had been debated and shared about since the wreck's discovery in 1985. However, in 2023, animator and historian Danny Molley theorized that the Titanic broke up in more than two sections, which explains the state of the wreck underneath the Atlantic. In this, Molley gave a dramatic account of what he believes happened when Jack Thayer and a handful of men on Collapsible B saw that night. Big shout out to Danny, by the way. At 2:17 a.m., Molley explains that by the time the Titanic was at an HT of 18.93 and SL of 3.57, the White Star Liner's decks began to show signs of failure when they began to crack. The expansion joints began to crack along the corner doublers, which then splits the ship into four sections. The main sections are the fore tower, the aft tower, the bow and stern sections. At the same time, the Titanic's keel was shoved upwards, and with the compression increasing the amount of stress on her hull, with the cracks continuing to spread around sea deck and on below galley decks holding the front tower, the forward engineering cylinders from their base, and this causes the towers to twist the bow, and it is the twist that is one flickering movement, the Titanic's lights go out except for her emergency lights. When the breakup occurs, the stern implodes, spinning and corkscrewing the Titanic with her bow making her way down to the bottom. As the front tower is thrown off, the bow and the two sections of the double bomb travel down at about 1,200 feet deep under the water, traveling eastwards. At the same time, the third funnel falls into the water, and with sparks flying from its base and the top because of the ignition by the guy wires. The emergency lights continue to shine for a further 20 seconds. When the emergency lights went out, the Titanic loses its remaining power apart from an oil lamp rigged to the main mast still shines. However, all the remaining people on board, like the chief baker Charles Yalkin, possibly Captain Edward J. Smith, who might have returned to the Titanic after swimming in the water, are left in total darkness. It is possible that around the same time and after jumping from the bridge wing, trimmer James McGann had reached the collapsible boat not long after he and a child climbed on. Then swimming along behind him was Captain Smith and the little girl whom he held in his right arm and clinging onto her waist. When he reached the collapsible, the captain passed on the baby to the occupants of the upside-down boat. A few people, which may have included Lightoller, attempted to pull the captain on board. In the first attempt to do so, he was washed off. Then Smith spotted another baby in the water, so he swam towards the lifeless youngling and thinking it might still be alive. He handed the second child to the occupants. When they attempted to pull him on again after handing over the second baby, he said, "Let me go, boys." Smith then swam back to the Titanic and he was never seen again. Following this event, the Titanic continues to rise in the air, and with the end of her stern sticking high with the railings and propellers pointing up to the starlight sky. Continuing with his breakup theory, Molley goes on to theorize that as the water deluges inside the watertight compartment number 11, the forward starboard engine cylinder dislodges further, increasing her port list and started to pivot to port. Rising first at a vertical angle, there were reports that people began to fall from the stern with a great height of 144 feet. Despite trying to jump into the water to avoid suction, some people would not survive as they would like suffer severe injuries or fall into unconsciousness when they hit the deck machinery like the propellers or in other people. As people fall, the ship's portholes burst under the pressure, and by 2:20 a.m., the stern picks up the speed of descending into the North Atlantic Ocean. 1 minute later, at 2:21 a.m., the Titanic disappeared, leaving nearly 1,500 people in the water.
Up to that moment, She had stood out as clear as clear with her rows of electric lights all burning. When the boilers broke away, she was, of course, plunged into absolute darkness. Though her huge black outline was still perfectly distinct up against the stars and sky. Slowly, she reared up on end, till at last she was absolutely perpendicular. Then, quite quietly, but quicker and quicker, she seemed just to slide away under the surface and disappear. As she vanished, everyone round me on the upturned boat, as though they could hardly believe it, just said, "She's gone."
When the final plunge came and it floated out off, well, floated off the ship, it somehow ended up, people were clambering on, you know, on the keel of the boat, trying to get out of the ocean. You've got thousands, hundreds of people trying to get on this one boat, and not just this boat, but also boat A as well, because these were the only boats that were practically around at the time when the final plunge came. So, you know, people were running towards the stern as well to get away from the ocean. But somehow the boat B managed to get pushed towards starboard. And it floated towards Collapsible A, and somehow they ended up practically together. And then the forward funnel came down. And I know when the forward funnel came down, it caused a wave that pushed those boats away. And the lifeboat B ended up going towards the stern. And I know people were able to see the stern go down. You can imagine it's towering over them, the stern standing practically upon end, and seeing all these people screaming and crying, and also you've got people thinking that they're going to, you know, because you've got all these people screaming and trying to get on this boat. You can imagine people on the keel of the boat that are already there are fighting people to get off, because they're going to end up, they're thinking the boat's going to be swamped.
However, before the Titanic went down, Chief Baker Charles Yalcombe was holding onto the railing before the stern was making his final plunge. According to him, Yalcombe mentioned in British Inquiry that he was the only person who was hanging on in the railings. "I was just wondering what next to do. I had tightened my belt and I had transferred some things out of this pocket and into my stern pocket. I was just wondering what next to do when she went. I do not believe my head went under the water at all. It may have been wetted, but no more than that." When the Titanic went down to her watery grave, the cries of over 1,500 were screaming in the water. These screams would haunt most of the survivors for the rest of their lives, and each one would later say the screams reminded them of things like a home run at a baseball game or a group of locusts on a hot summer's day. But most would develop post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD. One of them would be 7-year-old second-class passenger Ava Hart, who would say in one interview she gave later on in her life, "The sounds of people drowning are something that I cannot describe to you, and neither can anyone else. It is the most dreadful sound, and there is a terrible silence that follows it." Junior wireless operator Harold Bride would also hear the screams, though he was in a mental state of not caring about anything. "I lay there not caring what happened. Somebody sat on my legs. They were wedged in between the slats and then were being wrenched. I hadn't the heart left to ask the man to move. There was a terrible sight all around, men swimming and sinking everywhere." While Bride remained sitting, there was a familiar face who was sitting behind Second Officer Charles Lightoller. Earlier, it is believed that both Bride and Jack Phillips were reported to have reached Collapsible B together after returning in the water. However, since it was dark and not knowing how long Phillips was in the water for, somehow, he stood on the upturned collapsible. We know this through Lightoller's interview when he discussed with Phillips the vital message that could have saved many lives from the iceberg collision.
"Some little time later, I found that the senior wireless operator was standing just behind me. And from the wireless messages he told me he'd received from different ships, I figured up in my mind that the Cunard liner, Carpathia, one that he said was coming to our rescue, should be up about daylight. It was then I first heard of the Masava message, and when I said I didn't remember it, He told me he'd put it under a paperweight at his elbow and never sent it to the bridge. Many died from cold during the night, the wireless operator amongst them.
Jack Phillips died sometime in the night after staying in the water longer than Bride did. His lifeless body was left on board the Collapsible for the rest of the night. While one life was lost, another was found. After sinking underneath the waves with the Titanic, Colonel Archibald Gracie thought that this was his last moment on Earth. In spirit, he said goodbye to his family and that he'll see them again in heaven. However, Gracie miraculously survived by kicking himself free below the surface, and with the aid of his life belt, he swam towards a reflection of a bright light, possibly the stars in the sky above the waves. And when at last I rose above the water, I could see no Titanic in sight. For a brief period, Gracie found a wooden crate and clung onto it before he swam towards Collapsible B. Gracie survived his ordeal, escaping death with severe cuts, bruises, a wound to his head, and frozen hair. By the time Gracie arrived, there was an estimated number of 30 people on the lifeboat. These included 12 firemen and trimmers, including James McGann, a few crew members including Charles Lightoller, Harold Bride, the junior wireless operator, and two first-class passengers, Colonel Archibald Gracie and Jack Thayer. However, during the night, they had moments where the men had to paddle or push away from swimmers who were trying to reach the boat. The men were fearful that the swimmers would swamp the remaining survivors. However, the tiredness began to set in with the men, and some wanted to shut their eyes because they felt really tired. One of them was third-class steward Sidney Daniels, who would describe a word of advice from a stranger after beginning to feel exhaustion. I said to a fellow that was sitting back to me, "I'm tired, I'm going to sleep." He said, "For God's sake, son, don't go to sleep." Of course, fortunately, I didn't. If I had gone to sleep, I had never woken up again. It would have been so cold. But following the death of Jack Phillips, Harold Bright spoke to Second Officer Charles Lightoller about the information that Phillips never gave before his death. And while many people were beginning to lose hope, Bride's words brought comfort to some. In his testimony, Jack Thayer praised Bride for his positive enthusiasm, even though Bride's soul was dying inside. Harold Bride helped greatly to keep our hopes up. He told us repeatedly which ships had answered his CQD and just how soon we might expect to sight them. He said time and time again, in answer to despairing doubters, "The Carpathia is coming up as fast as she can." As well as the Carpathia, Bride informed Lightoller that the Baltic and the Olympic were on their way too. After hearing this information from the junior operator, Lightoller and Bride calculated the Carpathia would arrive around dawn, around 4 a.m. or a little after. However, as time wore on, Sidney Daniels would go on to describe the scene when the mood began to sour. "Nothing to do, just living in hopes." While someone started to curse and swear farther down on the ship, but someone said, "This is no time for swearing. It's time to say your prayers." To which we did, so we all said our prayers there. The Lord's Prayer. The first person who spoke to Daniels was reported to have asked how many Catholics were on board. It's not clear who this man was or how many Catholics were on board Collapsible B, but Colonel Archibald Gracie later wrote in his memoir that this anonymous person first made inquiry as to the religion of each of us and found some sorts of religion. The suggestion that we should say the Lord's Prayer together met with instant approval, and our voices with one accord burst forth in repeating that great appeal to the Creator and Preserver of all mankind, and the only prayer that every one of us knew and could unite in, thereby manifesting that we were all sons of God and brothers to each other, whatever our spirit and life or creed might be. In response, in all of chorus, the men cried out the Lord's Prayer and then the Hail Mary prayer. While prayers were shouted to the heavens, another miracle occurred when the last person to reach Collapsible B was Chief Baker Charles Yalkin. Before he found and swam to the lifeboat, Yalkin, it is believed, had swam in the ocean for over 2 hours and had only spotted the boat before daybreak. "Just as it was breaking daylight, I saw what I thought was some wreckage, and I started swimming toward it slowly. But when I got near enough, I found it was a collapsible not properly upturned but on its side with an officer and I should say about 20 or 25 men standing up on top of it." However, he discovered that there was no room for him. He tried to get on it, but it was pushed away. In the end, he hung around the collapsible boat, but he was recognized by the ship's cook, Isaac Maynard, who attempted to help Yalkin get on the boat. When this failed, Maynard held Charles's hand for a brief period. At 3:30 a.m., after attempting to live for around an hour and 15 minutes, the men on the collapsible had heard a sound of a firing cannon. And half an hour later, after the bright glow of the sun began to shine, a ship came into sight. Before the hopes were lifted of a rescue ship coming to their aid, third-class steward Sidney Daniels described how he became one of the first few men on the boat to spot this golden moment. Coming towards the dawn, more or less, the lights. A ship came in sight. "There's a ship," I said, "and there's two." It turned out that one was this ship. The other was the iceberg. They were on the side of each other. However, the rescue ship, which was later revealed as the Cunard liner, the RMS Carpathia.
Lifeboat number two was the first boat to get there, and Elizabeth Allen was the first passenger to board the Carpathia. And basically, there was no screaming. I'm sure people were in shock. There was no, you know, I mean, the passengers of the Carpathia were just wonderful. They helped people get dry clothes and hot to drink and things like that, you know, really took care of the survivors. Boxall was the first officer to reach that, because he was on lifeboat number two, and he was the first officer to reach the Carpathia. And when his boat was pulled up, well, when everyone was climbing up the ladders and everything, he would not leave his boat until every soul had left his boat. The Captain Rostron had summoned Boxall up onto the bridge to basically give him a statement of what happened, a true statement of basically where the Titanic is. But he would not leave. And then he went up to, when all the passengers had got off the boat and they were on the Carpathia, he went up to Rostron, and Rostron asked, "Where's the Titanic?" And Boxall said, "She's gone, sir." And, you know, hearing those words, I mean, the Titanic is supposed to be the most indestructible ship there is on the ocean. She's brand new. How can this even happen? So it must have shocked Rostron, and to know that Captain Smith didn't survive, because I'm sure Rostron would have known or come across Smith a few times, even though they worked for separate companies. I'm sure they would have come across each other. And he knew how experienced Captain Smith was. So to hear that he didn't survive would have been tragic. And to hear that all these souls had been lost would have been tragic.
While the ship was picking up other lifeboats, Collapsible B was slowly sinking, and in a desperate attempt, Second Officer Charles Lytar took command and ordered the men to stand on their feet and got them into a double column. When the boat lurched, Lytar gave orders for the men to lean to the left or to the right to help keep the boat balanced. This would continue to happen until three other lifeboats, 4, 10, and 12, came to their rescue. When he saw the lifeboats strung together in a line, Second Officer Charles Lytar blew his whistle and all the lifeboats arrived to help. Chief Baker Charles Yakum was pulled onto Lifeboat 10, the same lifeboat he was supposed to command. He was taken on board the Carpathia and got away with swollen feet. It's not clear which boat Junior Wireless Operator Harold Bride got into, but after the ordeal, Bride had suffered from badly frozen and crushed feet. When he transferred to the Carpathia, he would see Jack Phillips' lifeless body on the Collapsible B far off in the distance before climbing up a rope ladder to the ship. He would later join the Carpathia's wireless operator, Harold Cottam, where the pair sent out multiple telegrams, including personal messages from the survivors, until the ship reached New York City on the 18th of April. There's also no information on the lifeboat that third-class steward Sidney Daniels was on before transferring to the Carpathia. However, in his interview, Daniels would describe how he had a cup of coffee on board. "They hauled me aboard the Carpathia. They gave me something hot to drink. I used to hate coffee, but I didn't care what it was then. It was something to warm me up, to which I did. They took me down to the sick bay in the hospital and put me in a bed, shivering, of course, with the cold, and while there, I was stopped for a while. They had a roll call, but they were missing me, and I was never on the survivors list. I still never was." Luckily, Daniels was able to reunite with his family following this mistake. Third-class passenger Eugene Daly and trimmer James McGann's information on which lifeboats they transferred is also unknown either. However, Daly passed out before boarding the Carpathia and he remained unconscious until he was brought aboard into a spare cabin. After arriving in New York, Daly filed a claim against the White Star Line for the loss of his eulalium pipes. Like Harold Bride, McGann has also been suffering from frostbite when he boarded the Carpathia. For the rest of his life, McGann would publicly defend Captain Edward James Smith if anyone spoke ill of him. In one incident following the disaster, McGann snapped at a journalist, "How did he act on the bridge while I was there? I was directing the lowering of the boats himself, and he was shouting women and children first." First class passenger Jack Thayer was pulled to safety into lifeboat number 12, distraught and frozen. When he boarded the Carpathia, Jack was reunited with his mother and their maid. When they saw each other for the first time since being separated on board the Titanic, Miriam Thayer asked her son, "Where's Daddy?" In response, Thayer said, "I don't know, Mother." Thayer's father died in the sinking and his body, if recovered, was never identified. While on board, Thayer would console J. Bruce Ismay while he was hiding away in the Carpathia's doctor's cabin, as he would describe the sinking to a passenger named L.D. Skidmore drew a sequence of pictures based on the recollections. In later life, he would say, "It did not happen the way I described it."
Because everyone thinks that the drawing of the Titanic sinking through Jack Thayer's testimony of what he said to Skidmore was drawn by Jack Thayer, but it wasn't. It was actually drawn by one of the passengers on the Carpathia. His name was L.D. Skidmore. He actually drew the picture. Although it's not quite correct, he was the one that drew it. And he was the one that actually got to speak to Jack Thayer, and Jack Thayer was explaining what he saw. And obviously, Skidmore drew the picture of what was he perceived of how the Titanic sank. If Jack Thayer hadn't said the ship had broke up, well, not just Jack, but other people too, because, you know, Eva Hart said it broke up and all the others had said that it broke up. And at least 14 survivors in total had said the ship broke up. They saw the ship tear in two. And so thanks to Jack and other people's testimony, but Jack in particular, because it was Jack's that Ballard was focusing on, if they hadn't gave a clue or that clue that the Titanic had broken up, they probably wouldn't have found it, because they, you know, first they were looking for a shipwreck, but then when they found the Scorpion, and then he put two and two together, and then also put Jack Thayer in the mix of that and said the ship broke in two. They were looking for a shipwreck, but instead Ballard came up with the idea to look for the scatterfield, the debris, and that's what led them to Titanic. And everything else is history. And then it was discovered that the ship had broken up. Because when they went back in 1987. It was either 1987 or 8, I think it was 86. When they went back, they discovered then that the ship had broken up, that the middle part was missing, that the ship was in two pieces. But yeah, that's basically how Jack and the Scorpion and the Thresher helped Ballard find Titanic.
Second Officer Charles Lightoller and Colonel Archibald Gracie climbed into Lifeboat 12, though Gracie was unable to make the jump as he crawled into the lifeboat. Alongside him was a lifeless body that he tried to revive by while Lifeboat 12 sailed towards the Carpathia's gangway door. The person died before the boat could make it. Charles Lightoller was the last to board the Carpathia before the ship changed its course back to New York City. Also collecting passengers from the ocean, the Carpathia had unloaded the lifeboats. However, she couldn't carry all 20 of them. It was decided that the ships should keep at least 13 boats. 7 lifeboats were left floating adrift in the ocean, and this included all 4 collapsible lifeboats. Days after the disaster, Collapsible Lifeboat B was discovered, still lying upside down by the cable-laying ship, the Mackie Bennett, while it was recovering bodies from the ocean. The crew had attempted to bring the boat aboard, believing that it might still have bodies. This plan failed, The boat was also discovered by the RMS Baltic, but it wasn't recovered either. Today, it is not known what happened to Collapsible Lifeboat B. However, given the survival and the conditions it was in, it is possible that it either sank or drifted further away from the wreck site, along with a few lifeless bodies, including the body of Jack Phillips. Over a century later, the story of Collapsible B holds regard as a boat that played an important part in the disaster. It has been overlooked in the following years, but over on History Inside Nutshell, we hope that the story of the boat and its occupants will continue to keep the story of the Titanic disaster alive.